Welcome students. Now we go into the next concept called class imbalance, cross validation and confusion matrix of fourth unit of Python programming and data science. Myself G. Venugopal, working as associate professor in the department of CSE PBR with Kavali. What is class imbalance in machine learning? Let us see in detail one by one. In machine learning, class imbalance is the issue of target class distribution. If the target classes are not equally distributed or not in equal ratio, we call the data having an imbalanced data issue. There is a problem in the result analyzed by the machine learning algorithm. So that particular concept we call as the class imbalance. Whatever the classes that were defined by the models will be having some error, and that error we call as the imbalance in the actual class and the target class distributions. The class imbalance dataset examples are: number one, email spam or ham dataset, credit card fraud detection, machine components failure detections, network failure detections. But when it comes to the imbalanced data sheet, the target distribution is not equal. For email spam or ham, distribution is not equal. Then how to deal with imbalanced data? To deal with the imbalanced data issues, we need to convert the imbalanced data to balanced data in a meaningful way. Then we build the machine learning model on the balanced data set. So the techniques for handling the imbalanced data are: top 8 ways we can manage the imbalanced classes in our data set are: number 1, changing the performance metric. Whatever the performance metric that we use in designing or predicting the results should be changed. The more data, the more or the better. So if the data is available heavily, then the better results you can obtain. If the data are very low in availability, then the results are not properly generated. Experiment with different algorithms. So we should be experimenting with different algorithms so that the results are better obtained. Resampling of data set, use of ensemble methods, that is merging of different results into a single unit, then generating synthetic samples, multiple classification system, changing the performance metric. Performance metrics play fundamental role while building a machine learning model. Implying the incorrect performance metric on an imbalanced data sheet can yield wrong outcomes. So accuracy is considered to be an important metric for evaluating the performance of machine learning model. Sometimes it can be misleading in case of an imbalanced data sheet. In such circumstances, we must use other performance metrics such as the recall, F1 score, false positive rate, precision, etc. Second one, the more data, the better. Machine learning models are data hungry. That means if you provide more data, the machine learning models will provide more accurate results. So we should be focusing on the data availability in our data models. In most cases, researchers spend most of their time in tasks like data cleaning, analyzing, visualizing, among others, during an end-to-end machine learning process and contribute less time in data collection. While all of these steps are important, often the collection of data gets limited to certain numbers. To avoid such circumstances, we must add more data into the data set. Collecting more data with relevant examples of the undersampled class of the data set will help to overcome the issue. So we should be able to collect more data samples, more relevant data samples to the classes. Third one, experiment with different algorithms. Another way to handle the manage imbalance in data set is to try different algorithms rather than sticking to one particular algorithm. So we should be able to perform the process with two or more number of algorithms when compared to performing with only single algorithm. Experimenting with different algorithms provides a probability to check how the algorithms are performing by particular data sheet. Resampling of data set. To deal with the imbalance in a data set, researchers have introduced a number of resampling techniques. One of the benefits of using these techniques is that they are external approaches using the existing algorithms. They can be easily transportable in case of both undersampling and oversampling. Some of the popular resampling methods are random oversampling. Random oversampling seeks to increase the number of minority class members in the training set. It is a sample approach to resampling where one chooses the members from the minority class at random. Then these randomly chosen numbers are duplicated and added to the new training set. Random undersampling, the second one. Undersampling is a process that seeks to reduce the number of majority class members in the training set. It is a popular technique for resampling where the majority class documents in the training set are randomly eliminated until the ratio between the minority and majority class is at the desired level. Then fifth one, use of ensemble methods. The use of ensemble methods is one of the ways to handle the class imbalance problems of the data set. The learning algorithms construct a set of classifiers and then classify new data points by making a choice of their predictions known as ensemble methods. So a set of classifiers are used and then classify new data points by making a choice of their predictions known as ensemble methods. It has been discovered that ensembles are often much more accurate than individual classifiers which make them up. Some of the commonly used ensemble techniques are bagging, boosting and so on, bootstrap algorithms and so on. Generating synthetic samples. Synthetic minority oversampling technique or SMOT is one of the most popular approaches for generating synthetic samples. SMOT is an oversampling approach in which the minority class is oversampled by creating synthetic examples rather than oversampling with replacement. It is basically a combination of oversampling the minority abnormal class and undersampling the majority the normal class, which is found to achieve better classifier performance in ROC space than only undersampling the majority class. Then multiple classification system. Multiple classification system is an approach where a classification system is built for imbalanced data based on the data based on the combination of several classifiers. It is a method for building multiple classifier systems in which each constituting classifier is trained on a subset of the majority class and on the whole minority class. The basis behind this method is the partitioning of the set of samples of the majority class in several subsets, each consisting of as many samples as the minority class. So we will be balancing the minority class with the majority class for finding the results. Use of cost sensitive algorithms. The cost sensitive learning is a type of learning that takes the misclassification or other types of costs into consideration. The cost sensitive learning is a popular and common approach to solve the class imbalanced data sets. The popular machine learning libraries such as support vector machines, the random forest, decision trees algorithm, logistic regression among others, can be configured using the cost sensitive training. So that was about your class imbalance. Now we see the next topic, cross validation. If our algorithm works well with the training data set but not well with the test data set, then such problem is called overfitting. This we know very well earlier. So first, X is the input data, Y is the predicted results. Then the training data set, with the training data set it works well, but not well with the test data set. So there is a high variance you can find from this particular simple chart. To overcome overfitting problems, we use a technique called cross validation. Then what is a cross validation? Cross validation is a statistical method used to estimate the performance or accuracy of machine learning models. It is used to predict or protect against overfitting in a predictive model, particularly in a case where the amount of data may be limited. In cross validation, we make a fixed number of folds or partitions of the data, run the analysis on each fold, and then average the overall error estimate. Or cross validation is a technique in which we train our model using the subset of the data set and then evaluate using complementary subset of the data set. The basic steps of cross validation. The basic steps of the cross validations are: number one, reserve a subset of data set as a validation set. So we have to take a portion of the entire data set as a subset to consider it as a validation set. So that data, that a subset of the entire data set, is used for validation process, cross validation process. Provide the training to the model using the training data set. Now evaluate model performance using the validation set. If the model performs well with the validation set, perform the further step, else check for the issues. Then there are types of cross validation available. There are two categories of cross validation methods. Those are non-exhaustive and exhaustive methods. The non-exhaustive methods, cross validation methods, do not compute all ways of splitting the original data. Some of the important non-exhaustive methods are holdout method, k-fold cross validation method, stratified k-fold cross validation method. First one, holdout method. This is the simplest evaluation method and is widely used in machine learning projects. Here, the entire data set, that is the population for the model, is divided into two sets, train set and test set. The data can be divided into 70%, 30%, or 60, 40, 75, 25, or 80, 20, or even 50, 50, depending on use case. Actually, we divide the data set into two parts based on 75% as training data set and 25% as the test data set. But here it's not like that. You can take any portion as 70% or 30%, 60, 40 or 50, 50 even. See this, the data set is available. This data set is first divided into some portion, the training data set and testing data set. And the training data set is used for training the model, and the test data set is used for evaluating the model, whether the results were perfectly generated or not. We will be verifying using this test data set only. As a rule, the portion of the training data has to be larger than the test data. The data split happens randomly, and we cannot be sure which data ends up in the train and test bucket during the split unless we specify the random state. If you do not specify the random state, the data values may not be properly divided into the training set and the test set. So we have to definitely specify the random state. This can lead to extremely high variance, and every time the split changes, the accuracy will also change. Then continuation, one of the major advantages of this method is that it is computationally inexpensive compared to other cross-validation techniques. There are some drawbacks to this method. In the holdout method, the test error rates are highly variable and it totally depends on which observations end up in the training set and test set. Only a part of the data is used to train the model, that is high bias, which is not a very good idea when the data is not used, and this lead to the overestimation of the test error. Then implementation of holdout method in Python. So for this we use the scikit-learn model. From scikit-learn model selection, import train test split. The data is available in X, like 10, 20, 30, up to 100. Train comma test data is split using the train underscore test underscore split function. The data of X is divided into 70-30 percentages. The random state is given as 1. Now we print the data. See the output. Randomly the data values are extracted into training set and the test set. Here random state is the seed used for reproducibility. Then second one, k-fold cross validation. In this resampling technique, the whole data is divided into k sets of almost equal sizes. So the here iteration, in the iteration one, first 5 samples are selected as test data, the remaining as training data. In the iteration 2, again next values and so on. K number of iterations are performed here. The first set is selected as the test set and the model is trained on the remaining k minus 1 sets. The test error rate is then calculated after fitting the model to the test data. So in this case, in k number of iterations are performed with the first 5 data values as the test data and the remaining data values as the training data. When the results obtained, we will be testing the accuracy with this first 5 data values. And in the next iteration, the second set of 5 data items is used for the model and the results are obtained, and after obtaining the results, we compare the results accuracy. And in the third iteration, the third five data items, the remaining values are used in the calculation, that is fitting the model and training the model. Finally, after obtaining the result, the results are compared with this particular test data set. Similarly, at kth iteration, the last 5 data items are used as the test data. In the second iteration, the second set is selected as the test set and the remaining k minus 1 sets are used to train the data and the error is calculated. This process continues for all the k sets. The mean of errors from all the iterations is calculated as the CV test error estimate. So the calculation formula is CV of error is given by 1 by k sigma, where I is equal to 1 to k mean square error. The k-fold cross validation. Typically, k-fold cross validation is performed using k equal to 5 or k equal to 10, as these values have been empirically shown to yield test error estimates that neither have high bias nor high variance. But the major disadvantage of this method is that the model has to be run from scratch k times and is computationally expensive than the holdout method, but better than leave one out method. The implementation using Python. Similarly, sklearn.modelSelection import kfold. The data items are A, B, C, D, E, F, the characters received into X. Kf is an object created using kfold with the number of splits is equal to 5. Shuffling the data items is false. The random state is none. For train tests in ksplit.x, for train test in kf.split of x, print the test data and train data. See the output. the train data for the first time is 01. That means AB is considered and the remaining values are used in the training set. In the next set, 2, 3 are used and 4, 5 are used in the third set. So 2, 2 values are considered for splitting. Stratified K-fold cross validation. This is a slight variation from K-fold validation, which uses stratified sampling instead of random sampling. Suppose our data contains reviews for a cosmetic product used by both the male and female population. When we perform the random sampling to split the data into train and test sets, there is a possibility that most of the data representing males is not represented in training data, but might end up in test data. When we train the model on sampling training data that is not a correct representation of the actual population, the model will not predict the test data with good accuracy. This is where stratified sampling comes to the rescue. Here the data is split in such a way that it represents all the classes from the population. Let's consider the above example, which has cosmetic product review of 1000 customers, out of which 60 are female and 40% is male. I want to split the data into train and test data in proportion 80-20. 80% of the 1000 customers will be 800, which will be chosen in such a way that there are 480 reviews associated with the female population and 320 representing the male population. In similar fashion, 20% of 1000 customers will be chosen for the test data with the same female and male representation. So like this, cross class distribution, male maximum, female small. So round 1, round 2, round 3, round 4, round 5. After performing all the rounds, the classification, the data sets are properly distributed. This is exactly what stratified K-fold CV does, and it will create K-folds by preserving the percentage of samples for each class. This solves the problem of random sampling associated with holdout and K-fold methods. The implementation of the stratified K-fold cross-validation in Python. Here also we use the sklearn, scikit-learn package for stratified K-fold. Here X is an array that has the data set like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11, 12. And Y is another array with data values 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. Then we create an object called stratified K-fold, SKF. N splits is given by 3, the number of splits, that is K, the value for K is 3, random state is none and shuffle is false. So again we display the training and test data sets accordingly, and they are modeled properly. See this, train 1345, test data 02, train 0235, test data 1,4, train 0124, test data 35. The output clearly shows that the stratified split done based on the classes 0, 1 in Y. Exhaustive methods, cross-validation methods and test on all possible ways to divide the original sample into training and validation set. There are leave P out cross-validation. The leave P out cross-validation, in this method we divide the data into train and test sets, but with a twist. Instead of dividing the data into two subsets, we select a single observation as test data, and everything else is labeled as training data, and the model is trained. Now, the second observation is selected as test data, and the model is trained on the remaining data. See this. So the first data value is created as test data, remaining all used as the data values for training the model. Implementation of leave one out cross validation in Python. Again, sklearn is the package used for selecting the model leave one out. The data values are 10 to 100. L is equal to leave one out function, and we train the data using percentiles and rotations. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 0 is used as, 0th item is used as the test data. And in the next case, 1, then 2, 3 and so on, all the 10 attributes or 12 values from 1 to 10 are used for testing. This output clearly shows how LOOCV, that is leave one out, cross validation keeps one observation aside as test data and all the other observations go to train data. So that was about cross validation, and the last topic of the fourth unit called confusion matrix. Already we have been using the confusion matrix in every training model, in every machine learning model, like our regression, decision tree algorithm, random forest algorithm, or clustering algorithms. In every algorithms, we have been using the confusion matrix. But what is that? Let us see. The confusion matrix is a matrix used to determine the performance of the classification models for a given set of data or given set of test data. So the confusion matrix is created for the classification models only. It can only be determined if the true values for the test data are known. So we can create the confusion matrix only when the true values for the test data are available. The matrix itself can be easily understood, but the related terminologies may be confusing. So the matrix, if you see, already we have seen that. If you closely observe the matrix, we find that the actual results, that is the correct results obtained from the training data, are represented in one cell of the two-dimensional matrix, and as per the results obtained from the actual results obtained from the test data is represented in another cell, while the incorrect results are represented in opposite cells crossly. It shows the errors in the model performance in the form of a matrix, hence also known as an error matrix. Some features of confusion matrix are, for the two prediction classes of classifiers, the matrix of 2x2 table. For three classes, it is 3x3 table, and so on. If we are using X and Y, that is two prediction features only, then the matrix will be 2x2. If we are using three classes, then it is 3x3 model. The matrix is divided into two dimensions, that are predicted values and actual values, along with the total number of predictions. Predicted values are those values which are predicted by the model, and actual values are the true values for the given observations. It look like the table. N is equal to number of total predictions. Predicted is equal to no, predicted is equal to yes. Actual, no, actual, yes. True negative, false positive, false negative, true positive. So this is the data we obtain from the confusion matrix regularly. True negative, model has given prediction no and the real or actual value also no. That is called true negative. True positive, the model has predicted yes and the actual value was also true. So this is true positive. So we actually sum the values between these two cells, so for correct outputs, and these two are incorrect outputs that we have considered in our previous examples. The false negative means the model has predicted no, but the actual value was yes. It is called type 2 error. And the model has predicted yes and the actual value was no, it is called as a type 1 error called false positive. Need for confusion matrix. So what is a need? It evaluates the performance of the classification models when they make predictions on test data and tells how good our classification model is. It not only tells the error made by the classifiers, but also the type of errors, such as it is either type 1 or type 2 error. With the help of the confusion matrix, we can calculate the different parameters for the model, such as accuracy, precision, etc. Example, suppose we are trying to create a model that can predict the result for the disease, that is either a person has the disease or not. So the confusion matrix for this given example is true negative is given as 65, true positive is given as 24, false positive is given as 8 and false negative is given as 8. So here the predicted no, whatever the number of values predicted no are 68 and predicted yes values is 32. Similarly, actual yes is 27 and actual no is 73. From the above example, we can conclude that the table is given for two class classifier, which has two predictions, yes and no. Here yes defines that the patient has disease and no defines the patient does not has the disease. The classifier has made the total of 100 predictions. Out of 100 predictions, 89 are true predictions and 11 are incorrect predictions. The sum is actually done like this. 65 plus 24 is 89 and 8 plus 3 is 11. The model has given prediction yes for 32 times and no for 68 times. Whereas the actual yes was 27 only. And actual no was 73 times. So there is a little difference between these values. Then calculations using confusion matrix. We can perform various calculations for the model, such as the model's accuracy using this matrix. These calculations are given below. First one, classification accuracy. How accurate the classification was. Second one, misclassification rate. Then precision, the result, accuracy. And finally, recall. F measure. The first one, classification accuracy. It is one of the important parameters to determine the accuracy of the classification problems. It defines how often model predicts the correct output. It can be calculated as the ratio of the number of correct predictions made by the classifier to all number of predictions made by the classifiers. It is the ratio of the number of correct predictions made by the classifier to all number of predictions made by the classifier. The formula is accuracy is given by TP plus TN, total positive plus total negative by TP plus FP plus FN plus TN, that is total positive, true positive, false negative, true negative. Misclassification rate, it is also termed as error rate, and it defines how often the model gives the wrong predictions. The value of error rate can be calculated as the number of incorrect predictions to all number of predictions made by the classifier. The formula is the false positive plus false negative divided by true positive, false negative plus true negative. So precision, it can be defined as the number of correct outputs provided by the model or out of all positive classes that have predicted correctly by the model, how many of them are actually true. The formula for this is total positive by true positive plus false positive. Recall, it is defined as the out of total positive classes, how our model predicted correctly. The recall must be as high as possible. So TP recall is given by TP by TP plus FN. Finally, F measure, if two models have low precision and high recall or vice versa, it is difficult to compare these models. So for this purpose, we can use F score. This score helps us to evaluate the recall and precision at the same time. The F score is maximum if the recall is equal to the precision. It can be calculated using the formula. F measure is given by 2 into recall into precision divided by recall plus precision. and confusion matrix using scikit-learn using in Python. So already we have seen this sklearn matrix. From sklearn.matrix import confusion matrix. From sklearn.matrix import classification report. The actual values are these and the predicted values are these. Almost it has predicted correctly. Now the confusion matrix is created using the actual and predicted values with the labels 1 and 0. The confusion matrix is printed. Outcome values order in sklearn. NTP, FN, FP, TN. That is total negative, number of total positive, false negative, false positive and total negative is generated here. Confusion matrix of actual com predicted variables is given with reshape is equal to minus 1. The outcome values are shown here. The confusion matrix shows that 2 are from predicted values, 2 are from actual values, 1 from predicted values and 5 from actual values. So outcome values are total predictions, total positive 2, false negative is 2, then false positive is 1 and true negative is 5. So matrix is equal to classification report for precision, recall, F1 score and accuracy. Classification report of actual comma predicted labels is equal to 1, 0 and the predictions are shown here. The classification report is shown here properly. The precisions are given here, recall is given here, F1 score is given here and the support is shown. Micro average, macro average and weighted average are shown properly. So this is the end of our fourth unit. Hope that you could understand everything. If you could not understand some of the topics of this particular lecture, you can replay the video. Thank you once again.